Good morning, and I'd like to welcome everyone to the 11th meeting of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2022. And we are beginning this morning with agenda item one, which is an evidence session, with the Scottish Government response to the Expert Working Group on Institutionalising Participatory and Deliberative Democracies report. Members will recall the Working Group's report sets out a range of recommendations for how the Scottish Government's ambition for transformative change can be delivered to make Scotland's democracy more participative and inclusive. We last considered this issue at our meeting on the 20th of April, and we took evidence at that from the Working Group itself, which was very interesting. And I'm therefore delighted to welcome George Adam, Minister for Parliamentary Business, to the committee this morning. And he is accompanied by Doreen Grove, Head of Open Government, good morning, and Gerald Byrne, Team Leader of the Constitutional Policy Scottish Government. Good morning to you both. And Minister, I understand you would like just to say a few words by way of opening before we just pursue our questioning and see where we get to. So over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. And with your indulgence, just say a few words to start with. Thank you for the invitation to give evidence to the committee here today. I welcome the opportunity to talk about the IPDD Working Group report, the Scottish Government response to this, and our ambitions for the future of participatory and deliberative democracy in Scotland. I'd first like to thank the members of the IPDD Working Group for all their hard work. We value their input, which will help us build on the range of good work we have so far done in the field of participatory and deliberative democracy. And that's easy for me to say, Convener. You know, in many ways, Scotland is leading in the nations of the UK in strengthening our democracy. We recognise that the innovation in the field of participatory and deliberative democracy offers a range of benefits. People feel listened to. The trust in government improves, and we are better equipped to take complex and difficult decisions. Policies are better informed and more successful, and Scotland's democracy is strengthened. Scotland has so far held two citizens' assemblies. Both of these were established to deal with complex issues on the basis that the policy outcomes would be improved. We know that the evaluations of each assembly, that the members of each assembly, including the children involved in the Climate Assembly, enjoyed their experience, learned a lot, and want to take part in more activities. The combination of these benefits is why we have committed to running more regular citizens' assemblies, including a citizens' assembly for under-16s. We have also committed to offering people more opportunities at a smaller scale to be meaningfully involved in decisions that matter to them. These are big commitments, and we recognise they represent new parts of our democracy. We know that we will need infrastructure and new processes to deliver these commitments and to learn the lessons from the previous assemblies. That's why the IPDD Working Group was convened in the summer of 2021. We're now considering the Works Group's recommendations, and we will publish a response in due course. And as always, Convener, I am happy to take questions.
Thank you very much. And I mean, it's worth noting that this whole process began with the previous presiding officer's parliamentary commission, which I sat on, and which looked at the whole question of public participation and deliberative democracy. And a lot of work's been done here in the Parliament, and I know by the government in the time since. And I will get round to a whole series of questions that we had here, a focus group just last week with a deliberative democracy event to understand. And we'll touch on it later, but obviously one of the issues that everybody will be wrestling with is the expectation that is created by those, well, in the minds of those who are participating. And that, I think, will be quite a challenge in terms of the reputation and sustainability of the whole concept over time, because people will expect something to follow. But we'll touch on that. What I really wanted just to start off with some technical questions, really, and then colleagues will come in. But how did you go? I mean, we met with the group. It's a really very worthwhile and productive evidence session. But how did you decide, or how did the government decide upon the composition of the group? And I know Scottish Government officials were involved. Were they active equal members of the group, or were they there in a sort of supporting and advisory role? What was the kind of structure, and how was it put together?
You know, I could probably talk for about 5 minutes, but I'm probably better asking Doreen, who was at the coalface, with regards to this issue as well.
Thanks very much, and thank you for the question. It's an important one. So we looked across at bringing in expertise that could be seen as independent, but provide ministers with very clear advice that was both relevant to Scotland experience, relevant to the international experience, and looked at the learning from research in this field. So it was about a third practitioners who are on the ground doing this kind of work, many of whom were from Scottish organisations. But we also brought in European expertise, expertise from the US and Australia, and also academics who have done a really solid study, not least being involved in the work around assessing our two citizen assemblies so that we could make sure we were properly learning. It didn't just involve Scottish Government public servants. We also brought in someone from COSLA and people from the Parliament's own participation working group, and that was very deliberate and was approved all the way through because we had a clear terms of reference that was about setting out standards and values and looking at the overall way. There is a big appetite in Scotland for people to be more involved, but as you said, that can't just be random. It has to have some focus and it has to have real impact. So really the working group was very clear about trying to look at how that would happen. So that was what sat behind it. Public servants were on the working group. It was chaired by Kelly McBride, who you met last time. There was a real set of equal voices, but it was the expertise that we needed. That expertise wasn't sat in government, so that's why we brought in external expertise.
Thank you. And I mean, obviously, you haven't published a response as yet, but I mean, are you able to say in general terms what your overall reaction is to the report that you have received?
This stage, where Dorian and I were talking about this on the way over here, you know, as in all things in life, convener, it's probably best that we step back, look at the information, because part of the expectation of what the public are looking for out of this is if we get it wrong at this stage, then it's not going to recover from it, because you brought that point up yourself earlier on, convener. And I think we're going to take our time to make sure we get the process correct so that we can deliver for the people involved. But one of the things that struck me was when I was talking to those that had been involved in the previous citizens' assemblies was the fact that how enthusiastic they were about absolutely everything involved in it, how they felt that you know, it had engaged them politically again, which is obviously for us an important thing, because you know, we can all fall out and have discussions in various points of the day, but the public sometimes they take a step back from the whole process, and I think that's one of the advantages of this. So we're going to make sure we get it right, and we take time to actually deal with the issues that are there. I don't know if Dorian has anything to add or possibly contradict everything I've just said.
Oh, would I dare? I would, actually, to be fair. I think it is important to look at making sure we are learning the lessons. Quite a lot of work to do to look at making sure we can, for instance, one of the things that we really have to learn is around the independent governance of these processes. But independent governance means that you're at a distance either from government or from parliament. Making sure that it also has impact. So putting those processes in place. We've created a set of standards and values that the IPDD group have set out. So we're trying to work our way through those so that we can come back to you with a really clear view of how that will operate and to make sure we don't raise expectations that can't be met.
So, I mean, if you're being slightly circumspect then at this stage on what your overall reaction to the report is, would you go so far as to say that you feel that the group fulfilled your expectations in terms of fulfilling the brief that was set for them?
We do. And it's, as I said in my opening remarks, we thank them for the work that they've done, and it gives us an opportunity to just reflect on. And yes, it's given us pause for thought as well, cause for thought to actually see, you know, because we don't believe, and you may be surprised at this, because your government doesn't believe that we have a monopoly on all the good ideas. And it's always interesting to see what others have to say. So I would say the answer to your question, short, would be yes.
Well, that's not the official record, Minister. So, and I'm sure we'll all take great pleasure in quoting that back to you.
You will, but it will not be the first time of the
appropriate
last
time to test the water. I will dabble my toes in the waters of that statement and see what response I get at the appropriate time. But I mean, I understand, and having participated, you know, all the way since the Commission itself, and in other events. It's easy to set a timeline up and then actually, because we do this in parliamentary structures, to set up timelines, because in a sense we anticipate what we might be going to hear and think therefore we can benchmark when the next milestone will be. But with this and with the evidence you're hearing, you obviously, you know, hear maybe fresh thoughts and challenges and ideas that may contradict positions people held before. So in the sense that you are reflecting, do you have an idea in your own mind as to when you think the government will be in a position to indicate what its thoughts are in a formal way to the report?
I think, as I said previously, convener, I probably couldn't give you a timeline at this stage because I want to make sure we get this correct right from the start, because I'm a strong believer in any form of public participation in the process, political process. And we need to make sure that exactly what you said right at the beginning, that people's expectations are correct. So at this stage, I couldn't commit myself to anything. I'm not being difficult. If I thought in my head that there was a timeline I had, I'd probably tell you, convener. But I just want to make sure we get this correct.
But I think I would conclude from that we're not looking at anything imminent. It's going to be a reasonable period of time before we see a properly considered response. Would that be reasonable? OK, thank you very much. Paul Sweeney.
I think there's a major point raised about local government engagement and wider and deeper engagement with local governments. What would the government's response be to that recommendation about deeper engagement?
From my own perspective, Mr. Sweeney, I come from a local government background myself, as I've previously been a councillor, and my first experience of this type of engagement was as a councillor, where local authorities went out to various groups and said, this is our plans for the next year, what do you think, how do you think? And I was one of the few councillors that turned up at every event, mainly because I enjoyed the engagement to see what was happening. So I would say a perfect example of that is part of the Bute House Agreement, one of the citizen assemblies we're talking about is looking at local government finance and how we deal with that one. And that will be interesting to see what the public come up, because let's not kid ourselves, as politicians, it's something we've spoken of and had various ideas for probably over the last decade at least anyway. We've discussed, so it'll be interesting to see what the public do when they get all the facts and everything put in front of them as well, and I'd be interested in that. But I'm always one, we're always going to work with COSLA on that one in particular, and I'm always one for looking at these different ways. And it's not necessarily just citizens' assemblies, you know, we can also look at the people's panels and things like that as well at a kind of smaller level where we can actually get that form of engagement. It's about making sure that we do engage with the public and they feel listened to. And as a politician, one of the things I was quite interested in when I first came in at post last year, one of the first bits of work I got to read was on the Citizens' Assembly and Scotland's future, effectively. And one of the first things I said to Doreen was, as a politician, I'm trying to find out bits of this where I can deliver something to keep, as the convener says, the expectation of there's something to deliver here. And I found that one very difficult to actually pick something that I could say I can deliver X, Y and Z in that one, because it was so complex. And I think one of the things I've learned, having read that, and is that possibly as Minister, we should maybe, when we're asking these questions, define them. The ones like the Citizens' Assembly were proposed on local government finance, it's a defined question, you know, they can look at it. If I used other examples of questions that maybe we as politicians have difficulty with, and there's difference of opinion and quite passions, end-of-life choices. You know, I'm just saying that. I'm not saying there's a plan for a citizen assembly in that, but I'm saying when it's questions like that, it gives you a real idea of where you can go. And I think one of the things that I've learned is that, you know, I think it maybe less is more when you're asking the question. You get more value from it. And from my perspective, I've gone off on a tangent there, Mr. Sweeney, but effectively what I'm trying to say is I do believe that we should engage with local government on that particular example, but there's other ways we can work with them in public participation as well.
Okay, thank you very much. Just also want to know the government's view on how this fits into the wider open government plan, and particularly monitoring and evaluation of the work. How would you see that working?
Well, we've talked about evaluation. Part of what I just told you earlier on is the fact that we have to make sure that there is value for those that are involved in it. That they, because one of the things that struck me was when you speak to the people who have been involved in the Citizens' Assembly, it's as if their eyes have been opened to a whole new world of the politics wasn't for them, or the political process, and all of a sudden their eyes have been opened to it. Now, I want to keep that going, but at the same time, you need to make sure that that there is something you can deliver there. And if I am critical, I wasn't in post at the time, but if I'm critical of the way some of the previous questions were asked, was they were huge, massive questions, and it was difficult for to be able to actually distill that and to deliver and say, you said, we delivered. Mr. Carlo might be thinking I'm going back to both our respective car sales backgrounds here when I say that, but it's important. You know, I used to have there was a councillor in Paisley, Jim Mitchell, used to say, George Adam thinks it's like selling cars all the time, you know, but it's people. You know, people are people, and you need to work with people in a certain way, and being able to deliver and they feel as if they've got some kind of value from a process is the important thing. And that's one of the things I'm hoping that I can bring as a minister to put that in that direction.
Just ask a bit more about what the government's specific governance arrangements might be to oversee that exercise, to ensure like the outcomes, the satisfactory outcomes that you envisage would be achievable.
And at that point?
Thanks. I'm happy also to answer the kind of general open government question, if that's helpful. So open government as a something that we as a country signed up to now 4 or 5 years ago is about how we do government. What are the things that hold us to account, that make transparency important? But that last little bit of open government is how people can participate. So absolutely, this is front and centre of what we're trying to create is a public service that is confident and competent in order to involve people effectively. That's not everybody in every room, but it's looking right across the piece at how you get effective ways of getting people involved. We really strongly see this as supportive of representative government, much as the participatory work you do within Parliament. It's about getting the right questions answered and having very clear transparency around the process also gives you the scrutiny that you just asked about. So we would be very clear, and the IPDD working group proposed an oversight committee, which, much like the one that oversees the participatory budgeting process at the moment, that I'm sure you're all aware of, which will bring in a range of expertise. But also, because of the importance of Parliament, you'll see that the IPDD report recommended that this committee perhaps take a role in that, or that the relevant committee to whatever the issue around the Citizen Assembly, in particular that sort of scale of work, really is, there is a clear route. And these are some of the things that we're keen to set out for you as we do the response. So where those lines will sit and who does that and how it's done, and how we can demonstrate that there is that clear independence of governance that would give you that satisfaction.
Thanks very much for that. I just wanted to ask a bit more about how this fits into the wider agenda on participative and deliberative democracy. How does this report fit into that wider vision or objective?
It very clearly, it emerged because we are, as Mr. Adam already said, we're leading in the UK already, and we work quite a lot internationally with OECD and others, looking at how deliberative democracy can be established and can be really supportive in helping work through complex issues. So this committee, the working group, was set up in order to learn those lessons, to bring in the examples, and to set out how we think we can do it here in ways that support the government's priorities, that support really getting better decision making. This is about how we create that infrastructure and what it means to have a responsible way of thinking about how you involve people in decisions that affect their lives. Because if it doesn't do that, then, you know, it's wasted. So it absolutely fits with the community empowerment agenda. It fits with the developments around participatory budgeting. We are trying to make sure that it links right across to the outcomes, because if the outcomes aren't improved by this, then, you know, you find another method. And it isn't just about one method. So we use user research and design thinking, we use improvement processes, we use citizen juries, we use citizen assemblies and people's panels. There are all sorts of methods. It's about finding the right one to do the scale of the task. And as Mr. Adams already said, being really thoughtful what that task is. Not everything needs to go to a citizen assembly. Not everything is appropriate for that sort of scale of event. But one of the things that we're really thoughtful about is how you make sure that these all of this kind of work is properly inclusive. So what are the mechanisms to get the people involved that aren't generally involved in decision making? How do you do that? And how do you make sure you're going to the people furthest from government in order to make sure you pick everyone else up on the way back in? At your last session, you heard from Talat Yaqub, I think, who set this out really very carefully. And it's within government, we're trying to look at all of that advice from RSE, from Talat and others, to make sure that inclusivity is meaningful, that that's not just a word, that it's fitting into how we develop the participants, how we think about the ways that their participation happens, how we present ourselves in the room. Being really thoughtful where you hold this, whether it's online, whether it is in person, what support you put in place for participants to make sure that they can. That kind of pastoral care that makes sure that it can happen effectively.
Doreen brings up a valid point. It's one of the points I brought up early on as well, is the makeup of citizen assemblies and various organisations that we do for the, you know, I remember from my time in local government, a lot of the time, sometimes it could be the usual suspects that turn up at absolutely everything. David, Mr. Torrance is nodding because he remembers from these days as well. And one of the things I said, particularly with the young people, one that we're thinking of talking about, you know, my first thing to Doreen was, how do we get the young man and woman from Fergusley Park? You know, and I used the language of the hard-to-reach people. And then Doreen quite rightly corrected me at that stage and says, that language is part of the problem because you're saying they're hard-to-reach because it's just shorthand that we use as politicians to say. But how do we make these things valid and get these people involved? And it goes back down to ensuring that they're enshrined as part of the process here, and also delivery, and also making sure it's something, the question or what you're asking is something that means something to the individuals as well. But I'm not saying it's going to be easy, it's challenging, yeah. But it's one of the things that I want to make sure, because I don't want to be in a room full, have a room full of people who have, this is yet another organisation or kind of thing they've got involved in, because I don't think we get the value we really need.
I mean, I think your points and reflecting on them raise a valid point about the tension, inherent tension between representative democracy and participative democracy. And there's inevitable conflicts. I think we can all sit here and kind of notionally say, oh, it'd be great if everyone just agreed in this you throw everybody into this process and it will spit out a harmonious outcome. And very rarely in reality, in politics, there's power relationships, there's dynamics that are in conflict, there's potential for tyranny, whether of a majority or a minority. And I'm just keen to know or understand a bit more about your reflections, your honest reflections on the limitations of some of this. I mean, one example that always strikes me, there's two actually. Participatory budgeting, in my experience, can often be an exercise in the sharpest elbows win, and whoever can hustle the most people to an event.
Was right enough.
Things like that. And then, you know, another example that I often encounter is planning processes, particularly when there are consultation events, there are opportunities to engage, but it's only when people suddenly realise, oh, this construction started, when did we know? Uh-huh. You know, and then that's when you get the emails and you get the agitation about why is this suddenly happening. You're like, well, you should have got in touch 6 months ago when the guy was at the community centre with these notice boards about it all, and then I didn't know anything about it. You know, so I'm just saying there are already these examples which are defective. Is the government recognising where these limitations are and how to address them?
Yep, I agree. And I think it's... listen, sometimes we're going to ask questions and we're going to get answers that we probably don't expect. As you say, as I've already said, it will be extremely interesting to see what Citizen Assembly on Local Government Finance comes back with when they're presented with all the facts in front of them. And it might not necessarily be an answer that any of us in this room would possibly think it would be. But for me, I always use the example of how you deal with these things and manage things. Again, when I was a councillor, I was in Renfrewshire Access Panels. There's access panels for those with disabilities all over Scotland. I went into the room initially and it was angry people who weren't being listened to by the local authority. And then I got to the stage of exactly what you're saying, got them involved, the town hall's been renovated, you're part of the planning process, get in there, you know, and find out how we can make that accessible. And it's making sure that they can be involved and deliver something. For me, that's always going to be the most important thing. Is that easy to achieve? No. Is it challenging? Yes. But nothing good in life that's worth doing is easy. You know, and all of us are probably, we're used to the political process, as you quite rightly said, Mr. Sweeney, and how we deal with it. But this is a completely different animal, you know, and this is a situation where the public may, on certain occasions, give us answers that we will all be surprised at. But then, is that a good or a bad thing? Not necessarily. Does government need to take that seriously when it comes in? Yes, they do. Will that be challenging as we go on forward? Probably. But we just need to get the sleeves up and get on with it. Doreen?
I'll just add a little bit to that, if it's helpful. One thing is, there are examples around the world where politicians are involved in this. So in Brussels, the Parliament have members of Parliament who are involved in their citizen assembly. So we will get the learning of that. And I think it's really important that we do learn from those things. But power isn't a zero-sum game. We also have really clear evidence from the World Bank that where politicians get involved in really putting in place effective ways of your public getting involved, then you're more likely to be elected. So there, you know, some of these are myths, and we need to be really thoughtful about them. But what we're trying to do with this is make a process that fits with our current representative processes. So it's not about finding something that's in competition.
Thanks. That's really good.
Thank you very much, David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. The government's view on the group's definition and whether a minister sees any issues with him not being definitive. And the reason I'm asking that is when I asked Kelly McBride about definitive, the group acknowledged that there was no one set agreed definitions that can be used as best practice. So how does the government see this?
Best practice in regards to?
In regards to all the actions and the internationals that make sense for the definitions?
Yeah, well, as Doreen's already said, we look to the international experience regularly to try and find out what is best practice. But, you know, as I keep saying it, and I'm sorry if I've sounded from repeating myself, but, you know, this is the type of thing that's not going to happen overnight. We need to make sure that we get this to a place where it's right, it's proper, and it delivers what we want, what the public, more importantly, want it to deliver. And as I say, will that always be simple for us? Probably not. But we always look to... It would be difficult to actually define it I'll ask Doreen to come in at one point, but personally, I think it'd be difficult to find that definition. I don't understand why they came to that conclusion. But Doreen?
Wind that back. So the working group did actually look at a set of definitions. And Kelly's absolutely right, of course, that there's no internationally agreed set. The OECD have done some fantastic work, which Scotland's been part of, looking at what's been described as the deliberative wave around the world. And there are a set of definitions of process, and we can define what we mean by it. But it's important that we do that in Scotland and do it in a collaborative way so it makes sense here, so that what we're understanding is that we're all talking about the same thing. So we've got a set of definitions of what a citizen assembly is, what a citizen jury is, what a people panel is, and they will change. The whole point of this is that it's about innovation. It's about finding better ways to do stuff. And those definitions will be changing. We will constantly look at the international parallels. And Scotland has been a really active part of some of that international work, thinking about how we align this to existing systems, because every system's different. So definitions kind of matter, but they're a moving target, and that we will keep our eyes on that, but also try and get agreement on what they mean here, rather than this isn't about government sort of setting out a blueprint that others absolutely have to follow. It's about having a collaborative way. You'll have seen some of the ambitions in the IPDD report is about collaborative work in the future. That's because we recognise that the government doesn't have all the answers, that this really needs us in Scotland to look, as the RSE said, at that longer term, having a strategy around how we build the capacity and understanding around this in Scotland.
Definition, Mr. Torrance, I quite like Doreen's better way to do stuff. You know, that seems like it probably sums up everything we've been talking about for the last few minutes.
Sorry, I'm a fairly basic Geordie.
No, it works for me.
Thank you, Minister. Can I ask whether the government agrees with the commitments in the programme for government and the COVID recovery strategy can be more effectively delivered with routine use of participative democracy, and if so, how?
A perfect example is one of the people's panels, not necessarily a citizens' assembly, but the people's panel we've did in lived experience of those with COVID. And I think this is again, it's an example of, it's horses for courses. It's effectively, at this stage, we thought a people's panel would be the best to get the information that we could get from the members of the public that had lived with that. And I think, again, as us politicians, again, we get caught in the bubble that is here. And this gives us an opportunity to look at how the public dealt with COVID in itself. So, yes, to long answer short would be it's an important part of COVID recovery that we'd use options like this to be able to deliver and listen to in particular.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Fergus Ewing.
Yes, thank you, Commissioner, and good morning, Minister. And as the Minister knows, I'm very keen to get out with the bubble from time to time. Indeed. And therefore, citizens' assemblies are one of a number of different ways, convener, of achieving that objective. But can you, in all seriousness, say what are the key lessons that have been learned from citizens' assemblies?
The ones that we've had at this stage, Mr. Ewing, I would say probably for me, the lesson learned is the complexity of the questions when you're dealing with it. You know, I think you need to find a way where the public can debate the issue, and it's basically, here is the issue. You know, I think it was Ireland that did the abortion. They took a very difficult question for people in the Republic of Ireland, and they did a citizens' assembly on it, and they delivered on the process. So I think for me, it's sometimes it might be helpful for us as politicians and things that we've had difficulty, regardless of party politics. You know, it might be a way for us to be able to listen to what the public's saying. I use the end of life choices example as a perfect example of what the public has were led to believe a specific opinion on that issue, but the Parliament seems to have a different issue. Or if you look at the previous kind of votes that have been with Margot MacDonald's bill in this previous session, so you know they can be very helpful from that. But again, it's down to the actual. The question and keeping it, not keeping it simple, but just keeping it in a stage where we can actually, you know, have the discussion and just move on. You know, the complexity of the first two, you had basically climate change and Scotland's future. So you had Scotland's future and saving the planet. You know, big, big questions. And there was, if you've read what came back on both, very complex. And no definitive actual, you know, we want you to do X, Y, and Z, you know. And for me, and I don't know, it might just be me, but I'm trying to say, well, how do I deliver what the public have said here? And that's where I think, for me, that's a big important part. But Doreen's probably more likely, she's been involved on a day-to-day basis with all the groups, so she'll probably be able to tell you more detail.
I guess one of the things I'd like us all to learn, I guess, is how... effective people were at dealing with very complex issues. So one of the responses we very often get is from experts is, this is too complicated for people to understand. That's simply not the case. If you look at, and I'll use the example the Minister gave, the Irish Constitutional Convention met to look at a whole series of difficult issues for their constitution. And the Constitutional Convention said, well, we'll do that, but actually we would also quite like to look at these other two, which were both abortion and same-sex marriage. And their processes were designed to set out how people could properly understand it. So particularly the abortion case, that is something that was very toxic for almost any politician in Ireland to deal with. But in the end, what it meant was a very clear, because the whole process of doing a citizen assembly is about respectfully hearing each other's views, getting a shared understanding of the evidence, and then coming to some conclusions. So the recommendations from our two citizen assemblies are actually being looked at right across government. They won't be delivered in one big bang, as Mr. Adams says, but absolutely, we are taking those seriously and looking at how they can be delivered. So it is that the mix of a much more credible set of policies around particular issues, because you are dealing with the people who they're going to affect most, and being able to look at complex things, as long as you're given sufficient evidence and sufficient time to debate it. What it does, we're all facing more populist governments, we're facing misinformation. What it does is give people the opportunity to hear evidence, to hear a really clear explanation. And it's really important that that's balanced. It is cross-party, that it's really set out in a way that the participants are able to look at the issues and not the politics around it. That really, really matters.
Said there as well, as it gives government the opportunity to look at complex and difficult problems and make decisions on that after it's been the public had a look at it.
Okay. I also ask how the government's going to address the points on inclusion and equalities made in the report, please.
Well, at this stage of Doreen, can you
So this is part of a really clear programme of work in government around inclusion, the mainstreaming of inclusion, and this work will connect very clearly to it. So as I'm sure you're aware, citizen assemblies are randomly selected, but in all instances, they're also weighted to make sure that we have a broad cross-section of the population, and we would specifically seek to overrepresent places where people who are going to be more seriously affected by whatever it is we're dealing with. So we will work that out for each instance, but we will have a set of principles that will be applied. And it connects very clearly to that whole programme of mainstreaming qualities that runs across, absolutely across what government does.
Just to remind Mr. Ewing what I said earlier on about, particularly about the Children and Young People's Assembly we're planning on doing, is making sure the inclusion is like, people and young people across Scotland, regardless of where they come from, where they live. You know, I think that's quite important. The equality and inclusion aspect of this is extremely important in order to get the kind of balanced view back. And also, you're not getting the usual suspects turning up at various events.
Easy to reach out to children in what I think you said we can no longer call hard to reach areas, but at least everybody knows what hard to reach means. So is it not quite easy, because children tend to be in schools, and if you visit schools you can reach the hard to reach children in schools because they have to go to school. So I mean, is that not a simple answer to
we're talking about question that's children and young complex. People in themselves, who many, as we would be admit, have a cynical view of politicians and politics. So like, if I use the example I used of a young person in Fergusley Park in Paisley, not many. I might get away with going into Fergusley Park, as I am one of them, but you might have difficulty, Mr. Ewing. You know, so it's probably it's just a case of we need to make sure that we. Well, I've given a perfect example, you know, because I'm one of them, they would talk to me, you know, but we need to make sure that we, get, as government, can engage with them in that way and ensure that we get these young people involved in that process. Doreen seems to be itching to say something.
I was just going to add... I was just going to add that one of the things you see, mostly government talks to proxies, talks to people who head up organisations who work with. This is about going beyond that. And it's not to say that working with stakeholders isn't right, and in some places that's exactly what we'll do. But in this sort of circumstance, you're going to find people who aren't involved in any particular way. And yes, of course, we can go to schools. That's what Children's Parliament did, the work on the children's element of the Climate Assembly. And it was extraordinarily impactful. They did it in a really different way. And they reached out to the islands and to the highlands and, you know, to urban centres. So... we are trying to do this in a whole range of different ways. But, yeah, absolutely, it will be about reaching people that we don't normally reach.
Okay. Thank you very much. And we're going to sort of slightly return to where we began, because I think Mr. Stewart is keen to just pursue some of the issues relating to the recommendations and press a little further. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, you know, there's a range of recommendations that have come out from this review, and it's quite a wide range when you look at participation and also the understanding of the shared process. So it would be good to get an overview from government as to what your views are about the range of the recommendations that have been put forward, if these recommendations are to be implemented in full, and have you got any timescales as to how you might manage to do the implementation? And are there any that you would find difficult to deal with and may disregard?
To answer your question, timescales, no. You know, at this stage, we appreciate the work that the IPTD did. We'll need to look at it in detail, as I said earlier on. We need to ensure that we get this right. Will there be difficult things in amongst all that? Probably. Nothing easy, you know. If you're going to do something properly, it's not going to be easy. So we need to suck it up as government and actually just get on with it and do it in various points. So it's basically back to what I said to the convener's original part, is that we'll step back, have a look at what's there, and make sure we can create the process to deliver what the public are looking for.
But would you see there being a top priority, Minister, for what the government from the recommendations? Is there one area that you think, yes, that's where we need to be going and that's where we're going to go first?
None of the recommendations, and nothing jumps out in the recommendations as that's the go-to, other than the fact that I want to get this right. I want it to be of value to those involved in the process, and also I want to make sure as a minister I can say I was part of that process and we managed to deliver something that changed our democracy for the better.
And out of the report, there's the idea of creating a unit that will be there to participate. And can I ask, with reference to the government, the proposed new unit that is being suggested, and whether the government has done any costings of the implementation of the report's recommendations within that? Because that's quite important to make sure that if the recommendations are there and there's a unit going to be specifically involved in that, that there will be the opportunity to manage that effectively. But that can only be managed effectively if there are resources and proposals that can support and make that reality.
This very conversation as we came in, and I'll get Doreen, she'll articulate a lot better than I would.
So there's a couple of things in there. We have an idea of the kind, we know how much staff and resource went into each of the citizen assemblies. We know that there is a need for some of that to, if we're going to make good use of skills and expertise, you want to kind of centralise that. At the moment, what we're doing is looking across the government, where the existing expertise is, what can be pulled together in order to properly support this, what more do we need? So that isn't set out very clearly at the moment. This is clearly a recommendation that we will look at very, very carefully and see how that expertise can come to bear to make sure we have the independent governance, to make sure that we have the oversight. Not done a direct costing on what that is, though, of course, you've seen the published costs of the citizen assemblies. So it won't be so far different from that. And in the end, it will save us funding if there is central expertise, because you're not building it up and then losing it. The other thing I would say is that what this does in the end is create a way of getting policies that deal with the problem of sort of fiscal failure. So when you have better policies, in the end, this kind of participative work has to also help us with our budgets in the longer term.
As you've identified, you know, that it'll take time, but you've got some track record already about how that has been managed. Yeah. But some of the recommendations also have implications for the Parliament itself. And it would be good to get a flavour of how you're trying to engage with the Parliament to ensure that the Parliament in itself, the recommendations that have an effect here, actually do then become reality. And we will see improvements in the process going forward for the Parliament to actually manage the situation.
Mr. Stewart, and I think this committee and the evolution of this committee into what it is now is a perfect example of the Parliament being part of that participation and ensuring that we can, because obviously, as you know, it's gone from Petitions Committee to now being the key committee for all kind of engagement like this. And I think Scottish Government believes that we need to work with the Parliament to make sure to, again, it's all about the value for the process. And if you're going to be delivering anything that's coming from the citizens' assemblies or any of these types of groups, then we need to have the processes within Parliament where we can do that as well. So to me, that goes without saying that we need to ensure that the Parliament, and we'll work with the parliamentary authorities to make sure, as I said, this committee is a perfect example of that.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. The key committee, I'm sure you flatter to deceive, Minister. Mr. Byrne, you've been listening quite patiently to the evidence presented by the Minister and your colleague. I just wonder if there were any reflections you just wanted to contribute as we come to the end of our evidence.
It's only just on that very last point, you'll have noted that in the response to the Citizens' Assembly for Scotland, for which my team was the sponsor division. We did point to the constitutional significance of some of the recommendations for the Parliament. They need to work with Parliament in taking those forward, really to pick up Mr. Sweeney's point about how you have a participative democracy system working with a representative parliamentary democracy system, which making the two match together, I think, is the challenge for this committee as it looks forward. So I think I would just reflect on that as my contribution. A poor contribution next to Doreen and the ministers, obviously.
Years of civil service training that
Well, thank you very much. Colleagues, is there any final thought that anybody has that would like to pose an additional question? We have Minister, then, on that basis, thank you very much to you all. And we very much appreciate your contribution to the key committee considering these issues this morning. And I suspend the meeting at this point briefly. Thank you. Okay, welcome back. And agenda item two is consideration of continued petitions. And members will recall that at our meeting on the 8th of June, we held a roundtable discussion embracing four petitions relating to rural healthcare. And we heard from all four of the petitioners themselves, Gordon Baird, Mariah Aiken, Billy Sinclair and Rebecca Wymer. And we were joined in that discussion and very much welcomed the participation of our MSP colleagues, Rhoda Grant, Emma Harper and Colin Smith. Now, we heard during the roundtable discussion about a range of challenges facing rural communities, accessing healthcare services, including the distances, particularly the distances involved in travelling to appointments and travelling to appointments, particularly in emergency situations. I mean, some of these were, I think it was quite kind of vividly demonstrated when in a way that we might more easily understand sitting here in the Central Belt, it was said that it would be the equivalent of us going to Newcastle and back for a kind of a minor checkup, which, you know, brought home just the difficulties faced from some points in the area that maybe with which we're not familiar. And that really did bring home the extent of the distance involved. How this affected the recruiting and retaining of staff, which I think became an issue in all of it all, and how actually the voices of these communities are properly heard as new services are framed and developed, rather than those communities finding that those new policies are imposed upon them, really, rather than without proper consideration. And we agreed to hear the evidence on all four of the petitions at this meeting. I'm delighted that Rhoda Grant is back with us again, particularly in consideration of Petition 1890. And I'll come to that shortly. I'm going to, I think because we considered the four petitions together, it strikes me amongst the options that we were asked to consider was the potential to refer the petitions on. And so what I'll do is maybe just summarise the four petitions, and then we'll take a collective view, because I think that's very much the position that we would want. So, I mean, we heard in 1845, which was an agency to advocate for the healthcare needs of rural Scotland. This was the agency proposal put by Gordon Baird, calling on the Scottish Government to create an agency that ensured that health boards offer fair and reasonable management of rural and remote healthcare issues. And I mean, I was struck last week when Mr. Baird talked about what he felt were the inadequacies of the existing routes, which should ensure that the views of rural residents are heard by decision-making bodies. I think Mr. Ewing tackled as well on whether a single agency actually could manage the responsibility that could arise from issues which are common across health boards, very, you know, far flung across the whole of Scotland. And Dr. Baird also welcomed the establishment of National Care Centre for Excellence for Remote Rural Health and Social Care, but kind of felt that would only be part of the point that he was raising, because he felt very much that without his proposal, there wasn't really somebody advocating for these services rather than being part of the delivery of it. On petition 1890, the one Rhoda Grant has an interest in too, which is to find solutions to recruitment and training challenges for Rural Healthcare Scotland. This obviously calls upon the government to provide much more localised training, and, you know, to find ways both to recruit but also to retain healthcare staff in difficult to recruit positions in Scotland, quite often communities with limited resource in terms of even housing and other services, which mean it can be almost an unaffordable prospect for some people to contemplate accepting some of the positions on offer. And the petitioner highlighted how technology had enabled distance and remote learning to take place for teaching staff, which has supported the recruitment of teachers in rural areas. And she suggested that a similar approach could be taken to train, recruit and crucially retain healthcare staff to positions in rural Scotland. And members may also be aware that there was a members' business debate which has been secured and which took place last Thursday, I think, which Rhoda Grant herself led. And I wonder, Rhoda, just since you've joined us this morning, if there's anything you'd like to contribute to our reflection before I touch on the other two?
Really, to, I suppose, echo, and don't want to repeat what you've said, but to echo what you've said, and the issue seems to be from the very start of training staff all the way up through the system, there seems to be a systemic fault which is totally geared towards urban areas and doesn't focus on rural areas. And what's clear is if we can base the structure on a rural area that then works in an urban area. And things like during COVID-19, people throughout health boards started using the near me system, which was devised especially for Caithness to help save people travelling those long distances. So we need to have the systems in place and, you know, talk of a commissioner, commissioner or the like. Someone needs to advocate to make sure that the whole system looks at rural areas and makes sure that we are looking after their needs initially, and that can then well translate to urban areas as well. But we it needs to be a root and branch.
Thank you very much. And we'll come to just solutions in a second or two. Petition 1915, which was lodged by Billy Sinclair on the reinstatement of Caithness County Council and Caithness NHS Board. Billy's position essentially really was that since these services became under the aegis of NHS Highland and Highland Council, he felt that the local delivery had suffered greatly, and that, you know, this was very much evidenced by the 120-mile journey to Raigmore Hospital in Inverness, which many expectant mothers contemplate. And he has submitted a further paper following his session last week, of which members have a copy. And finally, petition 1924, which was the petition from Rebecca Wymer into a complete and emergency in-depth review of women's health services in Caithness and Sutherland. And her, you know, Rebecca stated that she felt that the services now being provided were in breach of basic human rights and was very concerned that, you know, there could be a loss of life due to the failures in gynecological care provision. And in the wider roundtable discussion, was very much one of the, you know, echoed the point about the difficulties and lack of attractiveness of people moving to positions in professional capacity in Caithness due to the lack of women's healthcare and maternity services, which, you know, people who are coming from areas where these are taken as very much for granted suddenly become aware that the absence of them is potentially quite a serious issue. And it was actually Edinburgh to York, not Edinburgh to Newcastle. I had understated the scale of the journey that was used by way of illustration. And again, Rebecca has provided further written submission. Now, I believe, you know, that it was suggested, I think, from some of our MSP colleagues that the way forward for these petitions might be for us to consider whether to refer them. And I wonder if colleagues have had any thoughts. David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. As a member of the Health and Social Care and Sport Committee, we are finalising our work programme just now. So I would like to refer 1845, 1890, 1915 and 1924 to the Health and Social Care Sport Committee in the context of the committee's wider consideration for health inequalities.
Alexander Stewart.
I mean, Convener, I would certainly agree with all of that. I think what we've found from all of these petitions is that the dilemmas that communities face, even with the technological advances that we've seen in medicine and the opportunities that can be dealt with from an urban area to a rural area, but that doesn't seem to be working in many communities either. So I think a more in-depth look at this by the Health Committee may well bring to the fore some of the areas that have been addressed and some of the areas that have been given in concerns by many of the people from the petitions themselves. Because, as I say, you know, the continued support that these communities have not received is really vitally important for their livelihood and for their support within any medical process. And I think that the Health Committee could do a much deeper and a more in-depth analysis of some of the areas that have been brought to our attention, and that may help to unravel and support the petitioners going forward.
Thank you. Fergus Ewing.
Yes, I support the reference to the Health Committee that David Torrance has suggested, and I think that in the evidence we heard there were many concerns enunciated about particular issues affecting people in rural Scotland, and most of Scotland is actually rural Scotland in terms of geography. I would also add that I thought that some of the issues affect, as I understand it, as a constituency MSP with a partly rural constituency, have not actually been raised in evidence, and that's no criticism of the petitioners. But, you know, for example, the availability of vaccination services locally provided by GPs is something that doesn't take place anymore because of the terms of the GP contract. And many people feel that that's an unfair restriction on GP practices that would like to provide vaccination and other services. And this is a hot issue right now, Convener, that wasn't raised, but I just raise it as an example from my own casework of a really important nitty-gritty issue. The last thing I would say is that it was raised in evidence, I think, by the petitioners, but also by Rhoda Grant, to mention her remarks, that the allowances paid for travel for those who must undertake operative treatment, for example, in Inverness, who have travelled from the Western Isles and who must stay in hotels and who probably drive, are woefully inadequate and completely do not cover the issues. Now, I suspect that is because of a UK tariff, because I've looked into this before, for constituents, again, that have had to travel from Inverness to the Central Belt. But I do think that the level of travel allowances and travel costs are a real, really unfair issue. And I just mention that in the hope that if there is a reference to the Health Committee and the committee so agrees, that these kinds of issues can be considered as well as the particular ones raised by the petitioners.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Ewing. I mean, I think that was a very important point, well made, and really very challenging, I think, for some people in the situation where that is the only option that they have. It really was seemingly an inadequate provision, basically, for them to rely upon. I thought that came across quite strongly. Have you anything you want to add, Mr. Sweeney?
Convener, the only thing I want to add was just the general point that I felt was a common theme across all the petitions was the issue of governance and a check and balance on structures of health boards. I think the rights of rural communities would be better enshrined in a formalised setting by creating some sort of statutory body that advocated for that and placed obligations on health boards. And I think that idea about setting a standard of safety, you know, that you could identify very clearly that driving such distances to access critical care would be inherently unsafe, therefore places an obligation on the health board to address that as a standard issue. You know, so I think there maybe needs to be some reflection on how that might look. It's not a clear ask or demand of the petition, but I think that emerged from the conversation at the evidence session about some sort of body that could actually say this is a defective system because of these reasons, you need to address it. You know, it's maybe equivalent to the housing regulator or something like that, you know, like where they can apply that kind of obligation on a health board. Because I think the idea that it could be done through the health board was kind of seemed to be challenged, because I think there was an idea that that wouldn't be, I think they're maybe prone to groupthink or whatever, I don't know, but it wouldn't necessarily come through just by having a rural representative on a health board. They would be very much drowned out.
Okay, thank you. So I think the committee is agreed to refer these four petitions to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in the context of that committee's wider consideration of health inequalities. So we agreed. And I think if the clerks could encapsulate just the essence of the discussion and members' reflection this morning of the evidence in any way in which we then offer that these petitions to the committee for their further consideration. Just a final thought from Rhoda Grant.
I haven't spoken to Mr. Sinclair in detail, but I did speak to him obviously just at the end of the committee last week, and he was pointing out that his petition was half about health, but the other half was about local government, and I think he was a wee bit concerned that the local government aspect of his petition might be lost. So I don't know if the committee want to look further at that themselves. I'm just making that point because
I think really in essence, in terms of the kind of general themes that arose from it all, I think we would still, I think, refer that on to the committee and as the best way forward from our point of view at this stage. But I take note of that. Thank you very much. And that brings us to agenda item three, the consideration of new petitions. The first of these is Petition 1932, which is to ban smoking in Scotland and develop a strategy for vaping. This has been lodged by Doug Mutter on behalf of, or Mutter, I'm not sure if it's Mutter or Mutter, on behalf of VPZ, and calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to impose an outright ban on smoking and develop a transformative public health strategy for vaping. Doug notes that the pandemic has triggered an increase in smoking rates and suggests that Scotland has lost momentum in creating a tobacco-free generation by 2034. He suggests that vaping is the best way to quit smoking and strongly believes that a public health strategy for vaping will help realise this target. In its submission, the Scottish Government has indicated there is little evidence on the long-term effects yet of vaping over the last decade of evidence that's been growing due to the relatively short space of time these products have been available, more space than there was previously, but even so. And as such, an outright ban on smoking in favour of a pro-vaping policy is not something the Scottish Government is currently considering. I wonder if colleagues have anything. Mr Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I would like to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government is not currently considering an outright ban on smoking in favour of vaping.
Colleagues, are we of that view? Yes, thank you. Petition number 1933, to allow the Fornethy survivors to access Scotland's redress scheme. This is a new petition lodged by Iris Tinto on behalf of the Fornethy Survivors Group, and calls the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to widen access to Scotland's redress scheme to allow Fornethy survivors to seek redress. Iris notes in the background information to this petition that survivors need acknowledgement, closure and compensation, and states that despite being in the care of Glasgow Corporation, the decision to exempt groups such as Fornethy survivors from the redress scheme has magnified their suffering. The Farnethy Survivors Group have also provided a powerful and detailed account of the range of abuse they suffered and the outcomes associated with this in the written submission, which members will have seen in their papers. In that submission to the committee, the Scottish Government states that it recognises that the abuse of children in all circumstances is wrong and harmful. But despite this recognition, and herein lies a common theme, I think, in relation to the petition we heard not so very long ago, the Scottish Government states that the exclusion of those abused in short-term respite or holiday care is in keeping with the core purpose of the redress scheme. Well, eligibility for the scheme is not based on how long a child was in care, but rather how the child came to be in care and the type of care setting they were in. And members will recall the petition that we have been considering about the abuse inquiry and the terms of reference with all of that. So I was quite struck that when I read the notes, that it's a different petition, it's a different set of circumstances, but it did seem to be, again, that the drafting of the regulations is quite tight and allows groups to fall through the net, which is acknowledged but not really without any resolution to follow from it. And I just wonder what views any colleagues might have had of reading these notes. David Torrance, have you...
Thank you, Convener. I think we should write to the Deputy First Minister to draw attention to the issues raised in the petition and to ask that we consider adjusting the current eligibility criteria to allow for Farnethy survivors and other survivors with similar experiences of short-term respite or holiday care to access the redress scheme.
Yeah. Alexander, Fergus Ewing.
Yes, I would very much endorse the course of action recommended by David Torrance that we write to the Deputy First Minister. I wonder if we may, in the text of the letter, seek clarification about why it should be that the criteria seem to be based on how people came to be in care rather than the experiences they had in care. If an individual suffered a wrong, surely that individual should be entitled to receive some kind of remedy of whatever sort, whether it's a monetary compensatory award or an apology or something else. It does seem to me that the criteria being used to restrict groups of people are at least open to question. The other point I just wanted to raise, Convener, and this followed a constituency case I had of not dissimilar circumstances, I think, although I perhaps will need to come back and check this, but my recollection is that part of the answer that the Scottish Government gave as to why this category of potential claimants were excluded from entitlement to claim a remedy was that Parliament had so judged in the passage of the relevant legislation. And if that's the case, I wonder if a little bit more work needs to be done to check out what the evidence was and what the basis was that Parliament came to that conclusion. That's my recollection. If that's faulty, I must apologise. But I think that is part of the reasoning that the DFM has adduced in a reply to me on a very similar issue. And if that was the case, it does suggest that Parliament has actually considered the principle of this issue before. And maybe that's something the clerk could check out for me to see if I'm just rambling on incoherently and talking complete nonsense, or whether I may have a nugget of a point somewhere.
Thank you. Alexander Stewart?
I think, you know, Convener, that Mr. Ewing makes a very valid point here with reference to how we should examine this. And I do agree with David Torrance's recommendation to go to the Deputy First Minister, because I think that this entire saga has and continues to unlock and show survivors and individuals across the care sector or the support sector or the how they were dealt with in this entire area. And I do feel that we should be examining as much as we possibly can so that we capture, because as you've identified, Convener, organisations and individuals amongst us are falling through the net. And that's the last thing we want to achieve here. We want to try and encapsulate as much information as we can so that we get the broadest views and opinions brought together. And I think by both the suggestions of David Torrance and Fergus Ewing, we'll achieve some of that. So I'm very supportive of that proposal going forward.
OK, thank you. Paul Sweeney?
Yeah, I concur with what Mr. Ewing said in regards to this about a need for a remedy. I think that's clear in the terms of natural justice. I think there's another stakeholder. Glasgow City Council is the successor body to Glasgow Corporation. Therefore, in question of liability would probably need to be discussed, and I think that requires a response from Glasgow City Council as well as the Scottish Government. So in that sense, I think we should also be making inquiries with the Glasgow City Council in this regard. I think the instincts perhaps in the bureaucracy is to defend against liability and extending liability, but I think in this instance that's the wrong approach. So I think we should be trying to establish a remedy for that, a group that has suffered harm.
Thank you. And I wonder why they might also write to some of the bodies representing victims and survivors just to call in aid to the argument and get some understanding of their views on widening the eligibility criteria, because they must be aware of the particular circumstances of the groups that are falling through the net and may in fact be able to identify others that they would say are in a similar situation. So we agree to do that too, together with the suggestions that have already been made. So thank you very much. An important petition, and we'll keep that open and see what progress we can make. I'll suspend very briefly. The Minister is now with us, and so we'll be able to take forward our final continuing petition just in a moment's time. Thank you. And welcome back again. We come to item 4 on the agenda, which is the consideration of continuing petitions. And we're going to be covering two petitions this morning that we thought to bring together on the focus of planning proposals and decisions relating to wind farm developments. The first of these is petition 1864, which is to increase the ability of communities to influence planning decisions for onshore wind farms. This has been lodged by Aileen Jackson on behalf of Scotland Against Spin and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to increase the ability of communities to influence planning decisions for onshore wind farms by adopting the English planning legislation for the determination of an onshore wind farm development, empowering local authorities to ensure local communities are given sufficient professional support in order to help them engage in that planning process, and to appoint an independent advocate to ensure that local participants are not, in the words of the petition, bullied and intimidated during public inquiries. And we last considered this petition the 2nd of February, when we agreed to write to the Local Government Association, who unfortunately have not been able to respond to us ahead of today's meeting. And we've coupled this with petition number 1885 to make offering community shared ownership mandatory for all wind farm development planning proposals. And this is a proposal lodged by Karen Murphy, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to make that community shared ownership a mandatory requirement. Our last consideration of this petition took place the 2nd of February, when it was agreed we would invite the relevant minister to join us this morning to give evidence in each of these petitions. And therefore, I'm delighted that we're able to welcome Tom Arthur, Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth. Good morning. Andy Kinnaird, Head of Transforming Planning. And Neil Rafferty, Senior Advisor for Heat in Building Strategy in the Scottish Government. Good morning to the three of you. And I know that the Minister has made a hot dash across parliamentary campus from another committee to join us, so we very much appreciate that effort. And it's all worked very nicely in terms of timing, as it turns out. And we're also joined this morning by, or I should say, welcoming back to the Petitions Committee, our MSP colleague Brian Whittle, who has a particular interest in the latter of the two petitions I referred to. And I will obviously return to Brian when members of the panel have had an opportunity to put their questions to our guests, and he will be well used to the format and protocols of our procedures. Members have a number of questions they'd like to explore this morning, so we're going to go straight to these. Some of this is familiar territory, so we're trying to focus the questions in on the issues that are specifically raised in the petition, and David Torrance is going to lead us off. David.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and to other witnesses. This is probably key to both the petitions. Does the Scottish Government have legislative competence to increase or abolish the 50 megawatt threshold for renewable energy developments that can be considered by planning authorities? And if so, has this been considered? And if not, have you spoken with the UK Government about the devolved power?
Thank you very much, Deputy Convener, and good morning. You'll appreciate matters pertaining to planning within the Town and Country Planning Act sit with me over 50 megawatts, as you alluded to, sits with the Electricity Act, which is a reserve piece of legislation. With regards to the means of adopting that, I'll maybe just ask Neil to come in with regards to what are our flexibilities with regards to within devolved competency to modify that particular threshold.
My understanding, and I don't work in that area anymore, is that we don't have any competence to do anything with the provisions in the Electricity Act, which affect consent applications for electricity stations. Whether or not that's something that has been explored, I also couldn't say. But the kind of hard and fast fact when it comes to electricity generation, supply, transmission, etc., is that there are reservations, so there is no kind of flexibility for the Scottish Government to do anything differently on its own.
It reflects the general reservation over, I think, energy within the Scotland Act, and indeed the processes that pertain to the consent process in line with that legislation are reserved as well, so it's not something that we have any direct influence over in this Parliament.
Thank you.
Okay. Yep. All right. That's a technical question asked, technical question answered in terms of our understanding of things. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you. Can I go on to talking about the treatment of pre-application consultations? Because that is an area that does create some difficulty with individuals, organisations and communities. And can I ask if there is any evidence that wind farm developments that have and how they are treated when it comes to the pre-application consideration is anything other than, as some people have seen, as a tick-box exercise? Because that is the perception that some have. And what is the Scottish Government doing to improve such engagement?
Well, the procedures and process are clearly set out, but as a consequence of the reforms in the Planning Act 2019, a significant change happening around the PAC process. I'll ask Andy to come in and narrate these particular points.
Yeah. Thank you. So we have some changes being made with effect from this October in the pre-application consultation arrangements, and this is a follow-on from the 2019 Planning Act itself. So coming into force on the 1st of October, there will be a requirement to apply for your permission within 18 months of the pre-application consultation having taken place, and that's about making sure that the consultation that has happened with communities is still relevant at the point that the application is going in. At the moment, that's much more open-ended. But also, sort of crucially, within the new provisions, we're setting in statute the requirements that need to go into the pre-application consultation report. So by doing that, what actually has to happen through the process. And the regulations will also add a second mandatory public event as part of that process. At the moment, it's just one that's required. The statutory provisions had been suspended by coronavirus legislation, which expires at the end of September, which is why the new process will come into effect at the start of October. All of these new provisions are entirely for that point, that we want to make sure that we are much stronger on the content and quality of that consultation with communities.
And can I follow that up? Because when we look at the sort of legal support and technical support that sometimes are provided, there is a question about whether the Scottish Government would consider providing legal and technical support to individuals and community groups appearing before public inquiries into the proposed wind farms and developments. Do you think there's any opportunity for that to become reality?
We already provide support to PASS, formerly Planning Aid Scotland, which can provide a range of different supports with regards to the planning system to individuals and community groups. The point I would also note as well, I recognise the concerns that the Member is articulating. I think there's also been, and we'll perhaps all be familiar with this, examples of some excellent work that community groups have done in engaging with the planning system and have set forth their views very robustly and competently and with a great deal of expertise and consideration. I don't know if there's anything you'd want to add to that, Andy. Yeah.
Let me just sort of pick up sort of through the inquiry itself. There's an important role for the reporter in managing the whole process, that the reporter will ensure that those who are perhaps less experienced in the planning system will be supported and able to give their evidence as best they can.
Because individuals, it could put them off not having that technical support or that legal advice. And in comparison to developers themselves, who may well have all of that in their package that they can bring to the table, that creates some disadvantages for individuals and themselves. So by the Scottish Government supporting that process, it will help to maybe unravel and support the communities and individuals that want to put forward their views and opinions. So in developing that slightly further, Minister, there is already opportunities for things to happen, but it still isn't at the level where the communities and the individuals themselves feel as if they are participating and being given that support mechanism. There's still a gap between what is being perceived and what is being achieved. And how do the Scottish Government see themselves reflecting that and supporting that to ensure that that gap is reduced?
I think on the specific points I've articulated around the support that's provided through the past, and he's addressed the issue of the role that the reporter has. I think your points will speak to a bigger issue, which is culture and interaction with the planning system overall. And it is a priority for me, is to sort of shift the dial and move away from conflict to collaboration. And that is about earlier engagement for communities within the planning process. So earlier this year, we introduced regulations to establish local place plans, which is a mechanism for local communities to feed in to their local planning authority in the development of the LDP about what their priorities are for their particular area. We are currently considering the responses to the consultation on new style LDPs, which again will provide opportunities for greater community involvement and engagement. I recognise that this is an issue that I think all members have an agreement from. We want to see more engagement for our communities in the planning system at an earlier stage, so that the conversation moves from one of conflict and discussions around what developments people perhaps may not want to see to a conversation about what people want to see for the future of our places. So yes, there's specific points around in terms of how the role of reporters, support through funding for PASS, but there's also that broader cultural change in the planning system which we're seeking to take forward with specific actions such as the introduction of local place plans. I don't know if there's anything you'd want to add to that, Andy.
I think that's fine. You've got that. Thank you.
Mr. Sweeney, just winding back slightly, you had a supplementary you wanted to ask in relation to Mr. Stewart's first point.
Yeah, it was actually in relation to question one on the 50 megawatt thresholds in relation to devolved versus reserved. Can I just ask, has there been engagement with Alistair Jack at the Scotland office or Greg Hands at Bays on this issue from the Scottish Government's perspective and maybe to seek a remedy of some description in terms of planning reform? So I do sense that occasions where these issues are raised, they are discussed, and potentially there are discrete elements that are devolved as a result, perhaps, or at least as a mechanism that can be established that might be worth taking as an action, if not, and perhaps this committee can support that effort by calling for those ministers to come before the committee in due course.
Well,
I'm sure members of the committee will understand the Scottish Government's position on where a whole range of powers should rest. But I'm happy to write back to the committee to provide further information and detail upon what the Scottish Government's position is, has been in this area historically, and obviously happy to respond to any further correspondence that the committee may have in this issue.
I heard you say that there were to be the incorporation of a second public event. And it just occurs to me to ask, I mean, is there a definition of what constitutes a public event?
It's not defined in law, but it's just expected that that it's the developer themselves that will engage, will advertise that they're going to be around, they'll engage with people from within the community, hear what they have to say, and that is happening before they finalise their proposals and submit their applications.
So do you expect that to be a physical public event that members of the public can engage with, or can a public event be a kind of holistic affair?
So as it stood since these provisions were introduced, it was a physical public event. The coronavirus legislation removed that temporarily, and what we have done is advised that virtual events should be happening, and that's what we've had for the last 2 years or so. When the coronavirus legislation halts, we won't be going back to the physical public events that will be happening. There has been a lot of support for the virtual events, so they seem to have attracted larger numbers of people participating. So there is a question that's being asked around whether both events need to be physical in the future.
Have you been able to evaluate whether when a public event is virtual as opposed to physical, whether that affects the balance of the developer's ability to influence the kind of conduct of the engagement as opposed to one that would take place in a physical way? I'm genuinely interested to know whether it has added a different dynamic which is pro or anti one particular aspect of the outcome that might be arrived at.
No, I think we've probably heard suggestions, but it's all anecdotal from both sides, whether it's an advantage to one or the other. It's why we haven't just gone straight on to sort of continuing with a virtual event as we can bring forward
so
the new regulations.
Pinned with any research as yet, not as to what that might be. Because my experience is the same, because I'm not sure is the answer. Yeah. And I just think as it becomes more commonplace that at some stage it might be useful for us more widely, even beyond the context of the discussion we're having here, to understand just what that materially does to the management and control of the outcome of the discussion. Mr. Ewing.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Minister and to the witnesses. Community ownership has been something that the Scottish Government has very much supported, and when I was Energy Minister in 2014, there was a Programme for Government Commitment, which states that we should secure the cooperation of energy developers to offer a stake in developments to communities as a matter of course. And I think across the board, perhaps in politics, this is seen as a very worthy objective, and one where much progress was made in 2014, 2015, where a target we then had of achieving 500 megawatts of locally supplied energy was met 5 years early, actually, which is not always the case that government targets are met 5 years early, I've noticed, Minister. There was 154 projects and £10 million of investment, and things were going really well until the UK government decided to pull the abrupt cessation of ROCs. Meant that this just fell off a cliff. But that's in the past now, but the response from the government as to why we can't mandate community ownership of energy is that the Electricity Act makes that challenging. But I do wonder, Minister, and this is the question really, you know, whether it's yourself or the Energy Minister or both of you, you know, have you approached the UK Government to seek approval for changing the necessary legal format, including the Electricity Act, if necessary, to enable mandating of community energy having a stake? So if you have 10 turbines in a wind farm development, you could very often add, say, one or two, which would be owned by the community. The developer would still proceed with the development, but the community would get a stake. bankers like Triodos, Co-op, Close Brothers back in 2015, as Mr. Rafferty will remember from his good work then, were very willing to lend, and they even brought the major banks to the table, funnily enough, to lend money. It's an extraordinary proposition that major banks lend money, but they even became slightly willing to do so towards the end. And therefore, you know, because there's an income stream, there's a bankable proposition for communities. It's entirely doable. And if I've gone on for too long, it's because I think this is one of the unmet big challenges of our time across the UK, given the commitments to renewable energy. So isn't this not the time now for the Scottish Government really to bring the UK Government to the table to mandate community ownership of renewable developments, which would be a tremendous achievement and legacy for people throughout these islands?
Well, the first thing I would say is I'm sure Mr. Union, I know for a fact Mr. Union and I are completely aligned in this. We are undertaking a process where hopefully we will not have to ask the UK Government for these particular provisions to be devolved, because we will have them in their Parliament and can have these conversations in full. I'm conscious, you know, with regards to my ministerial responsibilities, as Planning Minister, we all have a clear understanding of what the planning system is for around land use and what's appropriate for the planning system to ask of developers in terms of planning obligations and what is not. With my community welfare on, I recognise hugely the importance that community ownership and participation in renewables can have. I have seen examples firsthand right across Scotland, where it's in a vast, awe-inspiring scale, as in the Convener's constituency, or it's a single turbine in a remote part of Northern Lewis, and the impact that that can have in supporting fragile and remote communities, not only to sustain populations, but to grow populations and support local economic development. So with a community wealth building perspective, I absolutely recognise the importance. And while I recognise that these are ultimately, as things stand, voluntary agreements, I'm very alive to the huge contribution they can make locally and the role that community energy can play in advancing the community wealth building agenda. Specifically about interactions with existing legislation, I'd invite Neil to come in to say a bit more.
I'll probably end up repeating what I said earlier, that as far as I'm aware, there's been no engagement on that issue. But it's worth pointing out a couple of things. One is that the UK government has kind of recently followed along behind the Scottish government in publishing its own facsimile of our good practice principles and guidance for community energy and shared ownership, and extolling very much the same principles for the same reasons. So there's a common understanding there. I think it's also worth highlighting that because of the guidance that we've had in place for several years that Mr. Ewing, you introduced when you were a minister, there are huge quantities of community benefits going to communities. I think £23 million over the last year went to communities. I think we're finding that developers are generally quite front-footed about this. I think in over half of the applications currently in the system at the moment, discussions about shared ownership are taking place. There's a lot of momentum there. Hypothetically, could the Electricity Act legislation be made to or amended to compel discussion about shared ownership and community benefit? I don't know the answer to that, to be perfectly honest. My understanding is that we haven't had any of those kinds of discussion. Not sure what kind of reception or openness there might be to that.
As I mentioned earlier, response to Mr. Sweeney, I'd be happy to update the committee in writing on these matters as well.
Well, will that be very helpful? I did just want to ask one further question or area of questions, which is also important and which it lies within the Minister's portfolio of planning, which is the response to the Scottish Government seems to have been, well, we can't mandate this, but we can use the planning system to at least encourage or require it. And I haven't read the document, I must confess, but I read here that draft NP4 makes no reference of community benefit and only one passing reference to community ownership of renewable energy projects. And I mean, if I'm right in assuming that we want to use planning law as a tool to try to deliver more community interest, whether it is ownership or benefit or both or a mixture of the two, because both are desirable, although I think ownership is immensely preferable in the long term. But, I mean, if we are to use NP4 and the planning system generally as a means, a compulsator of delivery, why is there a scant reference to that? And just in passing, and this is not the Minister's responsibility, the same criticism equally applies to the Butte House Agreement quite extraordinarily. There doesn't seem to be a strong emphasis on delivery of these things in the Butte House Agreement, which, although I no part in the drafting of, one would have expected that this might have been a prime candidate, actually, given the political support for the constituent parties of the Butte House Agreement for community ownership. So can't the Scottish Government do more in NP4? And can, Minister, putting you on the spot here, in the final version of NPF4, can we not really use this as the means to deliver this policy by a much stronger reference both to the need for community ownership and, if that is not possible for whatever reason, strong and major community benefit, so that communities really do benefit from the natural resources which are theirs, essentially, to many people's way of thinking?
Just before the Minister comes in, I know Mr Sweeney had an interest. I don't know if it's an interest that matches Mr Ewing's passion for the for the question, but is there anything you'd like to add on that theme before we go to the Minister, Mr Sweeney?
I think Mr Ewing covered it fairly comprehensively. You know, I'm a bit intrigued to hear the Minister's response.
Minister?
Thank you very much for the question. We have obviously concluded the public consultation and parliamentary scrutiny process for draft NPF4 just over two months ago. We're in the process right now. We received in the region of, and correct me if I don't, over 780 responses. So it's great to see such engagement on this. And throughout the process of consultation, I had engagement directly with a range of stakeholders, including representatives of the renewable sector, as did officials as well. Central to what's in draft NPF4 is addressing our contribution to climate change and addressing the nature emergency. They're central. And so within the draft document, Policy 19 on green energy sets out our position. And that is consistent with our ambitions on onshore wind, which is to see an increase in capacity of between 8 and 12 gigawatts by the end of the decade. And that policy sets out in some detail within the draft about how we would planning can contribute towards achieving that. Now, of course, this is a draft document, and I cannot get into a position of speculating in what will be in the finalised version when we bring back to Parliament, but I would assure the committee that we are giving very careful and detailed consideration to all the representations we've received. I recognise the points that Mr Ewing has articulated, but we have to be very careful and remember the role of the planning system is around the use of land. And when we get into the territory of planning obligations, they have to be linked to a material concern with the development itself. That is a long-standing principle of how the planning system in this country operates, and it does so for very good reasons. I don't know if there's anything you'd want to add to that, Andy.
No, I think just summing that up, actually, that you know what is material in any decision in through the planning system must relate to the development or use of the land, and it must fairly and reasonably relate to the development that is proposed. It is about the development and use of land itself and can't come down to who may benefit as a result of the consent. And
it's not generally concerned with the issue of ownership, but rather the use of land. So that's very important to remember, and I'm sure members understand the reasons for that being why and how the planning system operates. But in terms of what is within the draft NPF4, there is a clear commitment and recognition that onshore wind has got an incredibly important role to play in meeting our obligations towards net zero by 2045, and indeed our reductions by 2030.
Mr Sweeney first.
Just wanted to flag up the... You know, it was actually quite an interesting interaction with the previous evidence session we held today with Mr Adam, the Minister, who's dealing with participatory democracy, deliberative democracy agenda in government. And I think there is a big concern over the attachment of community benefit to big planning projects, whether energy or otherwise, and I think that is definitely something that needs much more rigorous addressing in the NPF4 generally. I know certainly, for example, you know, from planning decisions made in Glasgow, for example, there's real concern in the community that just disappears into a budget line in the central council and isn't attached to actually material, tangible improvements in the community or the locus of the development. So I think there are clear issues there that need to be tightened up. So I just flag that as a matter that might be want to be brought into consideration, but also potentially as an interface with that agenda from Mr. Adams' sort of portfolio.
That engagement and participation within the planning system, which we touched on earlier, in very general terms, we are obviously, as you'll be aware, continuing our process of reviewing planning obligations, and we do have the provisions around an infrastructure levy within the 2019 Planning Act, which we'll be considering how we take forward later in this parliamentary session. So I just thought it would be useful to bring that to the committee's attention.
Well, it does occur to me, Convener, that you know we can consider the later a response, but one option would be to invite the Minister back again after he has had an opportunity to finalise the process, because I entirely understand he can't prejudice the process where, with 780 consultation responses, he must properly consider those before coming to a conclusion. And I also appreciate the evidence we've heard about the planning system only being able to do so much, but... But, you know, in life, things have always been difficult. And as Seneca said more than 2,000 years ago, he said, it's not because things are difficult that we do not dare. It's because we do not dare that things are difficult. So I leave that helpful thought with the Minister.
Seneca not throw himself into a volcano?
Well, maybe he just found things are too difficult. I'm sure of that problem. Yeah,
well, this little exchange of the benefits of classical education all round, I'm very impressed. The Minister may have heard me when I open say that the first of the two petitions was keen to appoint an independent advocate to ensure that local participants, in the words of the petition, are not bullied or intimidated during public inquiries. And we've received some written evidence which suggests that some individuals participating in public inquiries feel that they've actually thereafter been treated with contempt and abused by some of the wind farm development legal representatives. And somewhat to their disappointment, the reporter hasn't intervened when this has been happening. And I just wonder if the Scottish Government is aware of these instances. If it's always difficult because we have received evidence from individuals who've made submissions to us that this has been a practice. The reporter hasn't intervened, and I just wonder if there's anything that can be done to validate that, or indeed if it is taking place, to try and ensure there is a remedy to it, because it does seem unreasonable.
Yeah, as Andy Kinnaird outlined earlier, the reporter does have a key role to play within that process. I think, you know, all of our expectations would be the reporter would ensure the kind of behaviour that you are and conduct that you're relating in the submissions that you've received should not take place and is not acceptable. We want to ensure the greatest opportunity to participate, and the reporter, I know as has been discussed, has a role to play in that, and also recognising the respective backgrounds and positions that people are coming from within that process. I don't know if there's anything you'd want to add, Andy.
No, I think that's certainly our understanding.
It might be then that we will summarise some of the evidence that we've received, just so that you can be made aware of the experience of those who've written to us, and it might be something you'd care to have a look at. Mr. Whittle, you've been with us, and it has been my practice as convener to invite colleagues to make a statement, but also before we hear finally from witnesses, if there's anything that occurs to you that you would like to put by way of a question as well, I'm quite content for that to be the case.
Thank you very much, Convener. I think I would start by just getting the committee to recognise I represent South of Scotland region, which has a high propensity of wind farms, and my post bag reflects that. I was fairly interested around the question around the 50 megawatt limit when we have White Lease Wind Farm, which is the second biggest one in Europe, just sitting just up the road and down the road from your constituency and up the road from mine. So it's obviously perfectly feasible.
The second biggest, what's
overtaken it. It used to be the biggest.
It was the biggest. There's one in Holland. I was corrected. Apparently, it's now bigger.
I'm not keen on being second best.
Well, I'm not a silver medalist myself. I think, you know, one of the things I would say is just which you alluded to in your question, convener, was that. One of the things that's often shared with me is the lack of consultation, or the feeling that there's a lack of consultation with local communities, and that they are bullied and steamrolled, and that even when the council does decline to give planning permission for a wind farm, it is often overturned routinely by the Scottish Government, and there's a lack of connection between local communities and that planning decision. And to Mr. Ewing's point, that communities have to benefit. And currently what was described to me as there's motorways taking the energy away from where it's generated into the central belt, and leaving the communities where that energy is generated running on B roads. And I think that's a very good analogy. So it's extremely important, I think, going forward, that communities feel engaged. And also that communities benefit, which brings us to the point that we're talking about today around that community shared ownership and making that mandatory. And I was interested with Mr. Ewing's questioning, which I want to follow on from, around the fact that we could use the planning to encourage wind farm operators to ensure that there's a benefit to the local community. And it did. Andy Kinnear's response to that was around planning is around the use of land. But surely the use of land is there for the benefit of the community at large. So I don't see how the two can be divorced. And I certainly think that if planning applications were passed or not, depending on whether or not there was a shared community element to that, surely that would encourage wind farm operators to follow that route.
Thank you. Thank you for that, Mr. Whittle. Minister, if you and your colleagues might want to just pick up on that point, and if there's anything else you'd like to say, since formal questioning is finished, by way of any concluding remarks, we'd be happy to hear those too.
Certainly, I think I'll ask Andy to come in a moment. I think there was two points I would make. Firstly, as recognising the perceptions of your constituents, Mr. Whittle, with regards to feeling it was a lack of engagement or consultation with the planning system. I touched upon that earlier, and I do recognise that need and the opportunity we have with a new national planning framework coming forward and the rolling out of the provisions of the Planning Act 2019 to increase engagement with communities, because that's so important. I was earlier on this morning was giving evidence on town centres and the future of our town centres. Town centres offer solutions to so many of our big problems we face around climate change, around living local, around decarbonising and reducing our carbon emissions, and a range of other areas as well. But for them to be successful, it needs community engagement. People need to feel that they have an opportunity to shape their places. So I recognise that as a case in urban environments. I also recognise it's a case in more rural environments, and where there are applications coming forward for energy developments that communities feel that they have a role in shaping their place. And that is why, and I won't repeat what was discussed earlier on, but there's these various measures that have been introduced, whether it's the reform pack process, local place plans, etc., to enhance community engagement and involvement. On the broader point is, when it comes to the use of the planning system, it is about land. That is fundamental. Ownership isn't really a part of it. It's about how we use our land, and it is that for very good reasons. And that's why, where, for example, planning obligations can be used, it's quite tightly defined. It has to relate to the development and an aspect of the development and use of land. So that is established, and it's established and has been for quite some time for very good reasons. But
ask Andy to come in just to come in and say just a bit more on that.
Sure, and I think it's really, it's just sort of back up straight from that point. The existing guidance we have around community benefits and community ownership within sort of wind farms, that is already supported or encouraged through the planning system. As we just have to be very careful around that fine line of what planning is here to do about the development and use of land and not about the beneficiaries. So it's supported.
Thank you. And on that point, can I therefore thank the Minister, Mr Kinnaird and Mr Rafferty for joining us this morning. Also thank Brian Whittle for his participation. Colleagues, are we content to consider the evidence we've heard this morning at a future meeting of the committee? We are, and on that note then I'm happy to close this morning's meeting, and we'll meet again on the last Wednesday of the session on the 29th of June. Thank you all.